Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. Let us rise now and begin our worship. We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God, our Savior, appeared, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, so that being justified by His grace, in that divine hope, let us confess our sins to God our Father. Merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you by not letting you have your way with us. We have become deaf to your word. Because of our weak love for you and for our neighbor, we have become fruitless trees, deserving only your judgment. Therefore, we return to you today, asking your forgiveness and for the strengthening of our faith and love. By your word, restore us and renew us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Fruitful trees, the Spirit's sowing. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God to all of you, and in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed Lord, since you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The Old Testament reading is from the 55th chapter of Isaiah. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 8. So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 13. That same day Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea, and great crowds gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat down. And the whole crowd stood on the beach, And he told them many things in parables, saying, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seeds fell on rocky ground where they did not have much soil. And immediately they sprang up, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched. And since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and produced grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is what was sown along the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. And when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately he falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. As for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
grace, mercy, and peace be yours from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text is our gospel lesson, and I'm just going to read the last few verses. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. As for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Listening is one of the most important tasks that we have in life, and yet it is one that we often fail at. It is by listening to one another that we can have truly healthy relationships, and where there is no listening, relationships wither. Of course, we all love to be listened to, but unfortunately, we often aren't so good at listening. I don't know whether you've had this experience, but sometimes I've noticed that in my own conversation, I get so excited about what I'm going to say, and I begin to think about what I'm going to say when I jump into the conversation, that I cease to pay attention to what the other person is speaking. So I'm not listening at all. I'm only thinking about what I'm going to say. Well, that's the way we are often in our self-centeredness. We want to be heard and listened to, and yet we often ourselves fail to listen to others. When I was a missionary in Panama, I would go to a couple of Indian villages where the Kuna Indians lived, and fascinating people, very communal. They spent a lot of time in long meetings. Every night they'd have these council meetings, and they called it the Congress House in Spanish, or the Gathering House in their own language. But they would give these speeches. The different people would stand up if they were talking about different issues, or sometimes the chiefs of the village would actually sing. And these things would go on for hours. You know, their meetings would last 2 to 3 hours. But it was really interesting to me to notice what good listeners these people were, and that the habit of giving and listening to long speeches seemed to make them better listeners, even in their conversational life. So that I noticed when just 2 or 3 people were talking, they would do similar things, and that one person would talk for at considerable length, and the others in the group would sit there and patiently listen without interrupting. As important as listening is in our life with others, it's also vital to our life with God. The Word tells us that God's Word is life-giving seed. It is the seed that gives us life in Christ. But just like a seed, the Word of God sometimes doesn't seem to us to be that exciting. You know, you look at a seed, it's just a little brown thing. It doesn't look like much at all, and yet it has that power to create new life, and in time produce enormous trees, right? And of course, it also produces fruit, because you sow one seed and you get hundreds of seeds in return when you think of a stalk of grain. Well, in some ways, our willingness, or our lack of willingness, I should say, to listen to others carries over into our relationship with God. So Jesus' words at the end of this parable, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear," remind us to pay attention to the question, what kind of soil am I? How am I receiving the Word of God? How do we as a congregation receive God's Word? There are both warnings and also a wonderful promise in this parable. The warning is what happens to us when we don't listen to and hold fast the Word of God. The wonderful promise is that when we do hear the word and receive it, we will bear fruit for our Lord, fruit that will last. So we need to be careful how we hear the word of God and pay close attention to it. Satan would like nothing better than to snatch that word out of our hearts. Think of that situation by the Sea of Galilee. Large crowds were following Jesus. They hung on his every word. And so in order for him to be able to be heard, he put out into a boat a little ways from the shore so that his voice would not be smothered by the press of the crowd. There were no loud speakers. there were no electronic devices to amplify one's voice. It reminds me of a mission trip I took several years back in Guatemala, and we were in this courtyard, and one of the pastors I was with was going to give a message, but there were so many people in that courtyard, and they were all pressing very close around us, and we realized that unless he could get up above the people on the edges of the crowd wouldn't be able to hear the message. So we found a chair, and we had him stand on the chair so that he could project his voice above the crowd and be heard. So that's what Jesus did. He went out into that boat to get away, a little bit away from the crowd, so that they would be able to hear his voice over the water. Well, that crowd gathered around Jesus reminds us just how precious and important the Word of God is. They crowded around him because they were hungry for his truth. And we must ask ourselves, are we hungry to hear our Lord's voice and to know his word? I remember a colleague I had a number of years ago who bragged to me about the Thursday evening services at his church. They'd scaled down the service so that the pastor guaranteed they would be out the door in just 45 minutes. And my colleague thought this was just the greatest thing. He said, "We're out of there, we're in and out in 45 minutes. But I myself thought, I'm not sure this is such a great idea. You know, I worry about our tendency to want to reduce the time with our Lord to the bare minimum. Because God's word, just like a good conversation, requires time and attention. Jesus' words about the three kinds of soil contain warnings that apply to each one of us. Because even though we are believers in Christ, there's something about each of these three soils that still speaks to us. The seed which fell on the path never germinated because the birds ate it before it could be rooted in the ground. And sometimes, because of our hardness of heart or unbelief, or just because we're not paying any attention at all, God's word is of no benefit to us. Even though our lives are kind of a mess, and we do need help, and God wants to help us, we're not paying any attention. We're warned not to be indifferent to God's word, because only his word can counteract the lies of Satan and the world that are fed to us each day. Is our heart prepared to hear God's word when we come to church? Do we anticipate, I'm going to receive and think about and meditate upon God's word? Do we hunger to hear God's word? Do we read and meditate upon God's word at home with an attentive heart? And even when we do not feel a hunger for God's word, that does not mean that we do not need it. In fact, the very opposite is true. The less desire we feel for the word of God, the more desperately we need it. For if we do not desire to hear God's voice, that's a dangerous sign indeed. Because it's only God's word that gives us life. And it alone can sustain our life in Christ. Jesus says to us, "If you remain in me and my words remain in you, you are truly my disciples." Only if we remain in Jesus and his words remain in us do we continue to be children of our Heavenly Father. We need the word of Christ for our life just as much as we need water for our physical life. We cannot afford to have a heart which is like that hard path, which does not let the word of God penetrate it. And that's the devil's greatest priority, to keep God's word on the margins of our lives where it won't make any difference, so that he can just snatch it away. And then we will be easy to mislead. And then we will rely on our own efforts rather than the grace of God. Then we will be trapped in the web of our own confusion, rather than guided by the clear light of God's word. We are also warned by the example of the seed which fell on stony ground. It's easy sometimes for our commitment to the word to be superficial. We don't have a deep root. Jesus tells us to count the cost when we become his disciples, because being a Christian is not a matter of the mouth, it's a matter of the heart, and God's word must sink deeply into our lives. number of years ago, I read the book by David McCullough on the building of the Brooklyn Bridge. It's a fascinating tale of a tremendous engineering accomplishment of the 19th century. That iconic Brooklyn Bridge is a part of our nation's consciousness. Well, to build that bridge, they had to dig deep. And they made these caissons that the workers would be inside of as they were underneath the water, digging down, 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 down until they got to bedrock, so that those columns upon which that bridge rests would be firm and solid. And it's one of the tragedies of that construction is that many of these workers were permanently crippled by the bends, because they would be down in that high pressure environment deep under the water, and then they would come out and they did not decompress properly. So there was damage to their circulatory system. But think about how they dug deeper, deeper, deeper. God's word in our lives needs to be like the workers in those caissons, day after day going deeper and deeper, so that when the days of trial come, we will not lose our faith and we will not be shaken. Because God does not promise us an easy life. He promises to be with us in the midst of our trials. So our roots must dig deeply into the Word of God. Someone might ask you, well, why is church such a high priority in your life? Why do you read the Bible every day? So that our roots go deep, so that we can stand in the evil day whenever it may fall upon us. The third kind of soil is that which is covered by weeds and thorns. Jesus compares these weeds and thorns to the cares of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth. They choke the life of the plant so that it bears no fruit. You know, those of you who like to garden, you know that you have to weed your garden or it becomes a tangled mess. There's a lot of competition for our attention in this life. In our life, in our times today, I think it's only that way and more so. In the days before TV and the internet, our forefathers often made the church the center of their social life and entertainment, as well as of their life in Christ. There were a lot fewer distractions then, fewer things competing for their attention. Now email, text messaging, and the ring of the cell phone can reach us anywhere at any time, even when we're on vacation. And in all that clamor, the Word of God can be set aside. And Jesus mentions especially two sources of distraction that can literally choke the life out of us. One is the cares and worries of daily life, and the other is what he calls the deceitfulness of wealth. They're closely related. They both distract and deceive. Worry and care keep us restless, unfocused. We cease trusting in God. We become consumed by the concerns of this life, and there is no time nor energy for God's word. And the deceitfulness of wealth beguiles us into thinking that wealth is the solution to every problem and what we most need to seek. In English, we say, money makes the world go round. Everything depends on money. In Spanish, they say, con dinero baila el perro. With money, even a dog will dance. It would seem that nothing significant can take place without money, and that money can solve all our problems. But that is a deceit. It's not so. And in fact, the pursuit of wealth can distort our priorities. And in fact, we can see that when it comes to the things of God, money often gets in the way, because God works through His Word. And then He works through His Word in our relationships with others, not through buying and selling. Though money is useful also for the work of the kingdom, it does not make the kingdom grow. In the end, though we do not always realize it, everything depends upon God. He is the one who sustains the pattern of human life, the web of relationships that alone makes money useful. It's not an accident that the wealthy are harder to reach with the message of the gospel than the poor, and that the wealthiest countries of the world are the ones where secularism has advanced the farthest. The deceitfulness of wealth chokes out the life of God's people as they rely on themselves and their wealth and cease to rely on God. So as we think about those three kinds of soil, it kind of gets right at our hearts. We have to recognize we have been hard paths, impervious to the Word of God. We have been shallow. We have not dug our roots deep into God's Word. And we have been distracted by the cares and worries of life, the deceitfulness of wealth. It makes me think of Esau in the book of Genesis, when he came home from hunting, and he was this kind of profane guy who really didn't think much about anything that was very important. And so he was hungry, his brother's cooking, and in King James it was a mess of pottage, like lentil soup or lentil stew. And his brother, being a little bit tricky, says to him, "Well, I'll give you some lentil stew if you sell to me your birthright. You know, your place is the firstborn, the one who has the right to the inheritance." And of course, with that inheritance, we got to think about the promise of God that was given to Abraham, that passed to Isaac, and then passed to Jacob, not to Esau. Esau despised his birthright. He didn't value it. And sometimes you and I have done the same thing with the Word of God, this precious seed of life. We've despised it. We have not realized, we have not thought about its true value. And so we get distracted by so many other things. Well, the last kind of soil shows us the gracious promise of God. It is He who gives life and fruit through His Word. And of course, that fruit primarily comes through the Word itself. You know, sometimes we think we're going to produce fruit because of all the things we do, all the work that we do. And of course, work is important, and we do need to work. But finally, it comes down to God's Word is what produces fruit in our lives, so that even when we are old and can't do a lot of things, can't get out of the house much, yet if we are in God's Word, God will produce fruit in our lives. In the end, we are not fruitful for our Lord because of our feverish activity. God produces fruit in our lives through His Word. It is a work of grace. And today, of course, we're going to receive the Lord's Supper. And as we think about how maybe we have despised the birthright of God's Word, we can think about the promise that we have in the Lord's Supper. And Luther said, "Who is truly worthy and prepared to receive this gift? He is truly worthy and prepared who believes these words given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins." That is the bedrock promise on which we can rest. No matter how much we have neglected the things of God, we can turn once again to Him and find our rest in His grace through His cross. God takes and uses our efforts, but all of our efforts will come to nothing unless they are rooted in Him and nourished by His Word. And if they are, we will produce abundant fruit that will last for all eternity. Jesus' Word tells us of the abundance of God's blessings. It's all the result of His grace. Just as He saves and forgives us freely, so He also works in and through us to bring lasting blessing to others and praise to His name. It's like the way He works in the harvest. One seed produces hundreds of others. And so in and through us, God chooses to multiply His blessings that love and praise may grow and spread to all people and all nations in Jesus' name. And it all depends on listening. Hearing that precious word of grace and life, the gospel, and taking it into our heart. Just as our relationships to others will not flourish unless we spend time together in conversation and listening, so it is through hearing the voice of God and His Word that we come to bear fruit for Him. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all our human understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus and rooted in His Word. Amen. Let us rise now and confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. Then I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. We praise you, O God. We acknowledge you to be the Lord. All the earth worships you, our Creator and Redeemer. By your mighty word, all things live and move and have their being. We praise you for your creation. But with even greater praise, we give thanks for your recreating word, by which you have conquered sin and death, restoring earth's beauty and eternal life to all who believe. Cause your word to be received and believed by all people, giving everyone your new life through faith in your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy. For the glorious company of the apostles, the fellowship of the prophets, and the evangelists of your gospel, we give you thanks. Give conviction and strength to all today whom you have called to proclaim your word to this generation. Help us all, Lord, to be witnesses, to be rooted in your word, and so be able to bring that word into our conversations and to love others in your name. Bring forth the fruits of faith and love in all those renewed by your word and spirit. Lord, in your mercy. God bless our land with freedom and wisdom to acknowledge your holy word as the only sure foundation. Raise up servant leaders to guard, guide, and protect all citizens of our country in the way of your truth. And Lord, we pray for all nations of the world. We pray for their leaders also, that they might rule in justice and in mercy. Lord, we pray for peace in the nations of the world. We pray for peace in Ukraine. Lord, and as we think about the wildfires in Canada, we pray for your mercy and help. The world is experiencing birth pangs, Lord. Help us to hold fast to your word in the midst of these things. Lord, in your mercy. As you promise your own healing, peace, and comfort for your people, so surround all who suffer any need, sickness, or adversity. Grant that their faith never fail and their prayers never cease. Lord, we remember before you Betty Krause, Jen Masters, Jim Wenberg, Pastor Don Kretschmar, Margaret Solis, Mike Straka, Linda Straka, Ed Saunders, Veronica Hernandez, Clara Hawkins, Jeff Braver, Jay Koba, Padma Lacey, Marlene Jurgens, Rogers Brockman, Sherry, Tom H., Jerry Clemens, Carmen Baltz, Katie, Emily Montes, Kevin Warfel. Lord, give to these brothers and sisters strength and help them to trust in you in the midst of their affliction. We also pray for your peace and comfort for the family of Thad Daniels and for the family of Carol Shefkes, Patty Townsend's mother. Lord, bring to these families the hope and peace that can only come from your word, the knowledge of the resurrection to eternal life. And help us all, Lord, to number our days that we may apply our hearts to the wisdom of your word. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So at this time, we just a reminder of that our offerings are part of our service and worship to God, and you may give your offering through text, and we will sing the offertory at this time. Be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, whom you anointed to proclaim good news to the poor, freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, and to set the oppressed free. By his preaching and teaching, and by the blood of his death and his glorious resurrection, he has fulfilled your will. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of the sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. May this true of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. Almighty God, grant to your church, your Holy Spirit, and the wisdom that comes down from above, that your word may not be bound, but have free course, and be preached to the joy and edifying of Christ's holy people, that in steadfast faith we may serve you, and in the confession of your name may abide to the end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.